Good afternoon and welcome. My name is Michelle Rosato and I work at the Connecticut State Department of Education in the Performance Office. Thank you for taking the time today to participate in the first of a webinar series by the CSCE's Professional Support for Districts. We want you to know that the staff of the CSCE is here to support you in every way possible, and we hope that you and your families continue to be well during this time. Today's call focuses on guidance for special education, but before we get started, let's do a little bit of housekeeping for you attendees. All attendees on the webinar are in listen-only mode, but if you need to ask a question, please use the Q&A or the chat feature, which you will see in the box in the webinar controls. Questions will be addressed as time permits by the presenters at the conclusion of the session. And just as a reminder, this session is being recorded and will be posted to the CSCE's website. Our presenters today are Charlene Russell Tucker, Deputy Commissioner, Connecticut State Department of Education, Jessa Myrtle, Legal Director, Connecticut Department of Education, and Brian Klimkowitz, Division Director, Bureau of Special Education at the Connecticut Department of Education. Great, I'm gonna kick it off and give it to Charlene Russell Tucker, who's gonna get started. Thanks, Charlene.
Thank you, Michelle, and welcome all to our webinar today. Michelle mentioned, my name is Charlene Russell Tucker, Deputy Commissioner of Education, and great to be talking to all of you. I'm very pleased that you've joined us, and I'm so pleased to be joined by my colleagues, Jessa Myrtle, our Legal Director, and Brian Klimkowitz. Both you will hear soon. And, you know, over 150 of you registered for today, and we're up to about 126 of you that's already on right now. This signifies your keen interest in supporting all our students as you implement continued education opportunities for all students in your respective districts. So first, I hope that for all of you on the call that you and your families are safe and are doing well. And in our time together today, we'll provide a brief overview of the March 24th, 2020 guidance document. There'll be an opportunity for participants to submit questions about the document that we can answer in the session. Of course, some of them we may not be able to, and we'll certainly hold on to that. The questions that are not answered during the session may be submitted for future response and will inform future guidance as we go forward. As you all know, I am sure you're listening and paying attention keenly as the landscape of this pandemic is certainly changing. I recall when we started back in February to think about what would happen around school and schooling during the time, of course, at that time, it wasn't yet a pandemic when we got started. We were thinking about short-term school closures, maybe a maximum of 2 weeks, and now here we are. So as you can well imagine, we're making adjustments as the conditions change and as we learn more from our public health leaders. Education is different today for all our students as the pandemic is impacting all students and especially our students with disabilities. Our primary focus always is health and safety, your health, your safety, that of our students, our educators, and our families. And we have worked very closely with the Department of Public Health to develop and disseminate safety guidance on distribution of meals and education supplies. If that has not reached down to you yet, please check our website. It's posted there, along with many other resources, including our communication to superintendents. So Michelle mentioned our professional support series for districts and also for families. They're also posted on our site, and please take advantage of those, as we have noted there, and share them with your colleagues, and also share them with families so they can also participate. The department is here to support you through this time. A majority of our staff members are working remotely to abide by the governor's stay home order. However, you should know that every morning our leadership team, including the colleagues on the phone, on the call, the webinar today, our commissioner and others, we meet remotely to address issues, emerging concerns, so that we can both respond and remain proactive in supporting you as you support your own families, your colleagues, our students, and their families. So thank you for your continued vigilance and resilience in the face of these unprecedented times. We will get through it together. And so with that, I will turn things over to our colleague Jessa at this time. Thank you.
Thank you, Charlene. I appreciate it. And thank you to everyone who's taken the time to come to listen to our feedback and information today. It is important to again acknowledge the fact that these are unprecedented times and that there may be constant changing and evolving response required. Given the circumstances, we have been receiving feedback from many perspectives, with ongoing conversations with other state agencies, other resources, child advocate, attorneys, legal aid, to try to ensure that we understand a broad perspective on the guidance that we are providing. While I'm going to summarize some of the governor's executive orders related to classroom closure and the 180 days required, I want to note that a lot of the executive orders that perhaps don't directly impact school cancellation of classes do emphasize the important message that safety is very much first. You'll notice that the executive orders have at this point limited contact recommendations to 5 people or fewer, and that really changes the perspective that we have related to education and how we provide education to our students. So to first address the governor's executive order related to the 180 day waivers, you may be aware that there was an initial executive order that provided for a 180 day waiver only when schools were going to certify that they were providing legally compliant distance learning opportunities. As my colleague, Deputy Russell Tucker, indicated, in some ways, the evolution of this pandemic had changed the perspective after that executive order was issued, in the sense that initially it was contemplated that there may have been short-term closures, in some cases even as short as 3 days to do a deep cleaning. And it was subsequently recommended by the CDC that those closures would likely be much longer periods of time. When the governor's executive order addressed that longer period of time for closure, the cancellation of classes indicated that schools should provide continued educational opportunities to the greatest extent possible. We are aware that that is an evolving concept for many schools, and so we are trying to provide guidance and support to ensure that we're addressing any associated equity issues. Executive order, another executive order that is extremely relevant and important, is Executive Order 7M, which was recently put out to authorize the commissioners of state agencies to suspend or modify administrative deadlines. You will hear a little bit more about that in the context of our due process and other mediation processes in the context of special education. But that indicated an intent from the governor to ensure that there was some flexibility around what would typically be relatively strict guidelines. And most recently, in Executive Order 7R, the governor clarified that the state will continue to provide funding for boards of education consistent with what their expectations are in order to sustain staff and ensure that there's the ability to have continuity of education when school class cancellations end. Importantly, Executive Order 7R also addressed contracts with special education providers. The executive order required that unless a school plans to continue its contract, it must negotiate an amendment on the contract in order to address continuity of services, particularly when class resumes, as well as to sustain support for the staff members of certain special education provider entities, including approved special education providers. My colleague, Brian, I'm sure will provide some additional content on that. But those are the three executive orders that are most relevant to the school populations. We've also received some feedback from our federal partners at the U.S. Department of Education. We anticipate that that will be evolving and updated, and that we will need to continue to update our own guidance as we receive information from the U.S. Department of Education. But I would like to outline a few of the pieces of information provided by those federal partners and bring to your attention where those guidance documents are located. The Office of Civil Rights, The Office of Civil Rights fact sheet was the March 16th document that addressed some of the risk factors and in protecting the civil rights of students. The Office of Special Education Rehabilitative Services, OSERS, also provided question and answers related to services for children with disabilities during the COVID outbreak. As we know, there was a supplemental fact sheet that was issued, which was intended by the U.S. Department of Education to clarify the federal guidance. And you can see on your screen a quote that I thought was important, and they thought it was important enough to place it in bold on their fact sheet, that we should be clear that ensuring compliance with the IDEA, Section 504, and Title II of the ADA should not prevent any school from offering educational programs through distance instruction. All of those documents provide some answers and perhaps provide some questions, and we will continue to work with our federal partners to ensure that we receive updates and answers to those questions. But I think the bottom line in all of those documents is to confirm that while safety is first, compliance with the CDC's recommendations should not create civil rights or equity concerns. With that, I'm going to turn over some of the details related to that guidance, as well as the guidance that is being provided by the State Department of Education, to Brian Klimkiewicz, and I will be available to assist in answering questions at the end of this webinar.
Thank you, Jessa. First, I just wanted to say that I'm honored to represent the Bureau of Special Education within the department in our work to support the leadership of our Commissioner, Dr. Miguel Cardona, Deputy Commissioners Charlene Russell-Tucker and Desi Nesmith, and our Legal Director, Jessa Myrtle. The Bureau's mission is to provide leadership to ensure that students with disabilities receive a free, appropriate public education that prepares them for college or training, employment, independent living, and community participation, and to ensure compliance with special education laws and regulations. And I apologize for the slides. Looks like they're advanced a little bit further than I would like. The CSD building in Hartford remains open. However, as Deputy Commissioner mentioned, most of our team now is working from home, adhering to the governor's requests, stay home and stay safe. Although we are working remotely, our office is fully operational and here to support your efforts. Our department's work on required activities continues, as you can see on your screen. Our work related to the state systemic improvement plan. Our report was sent to the to OSEP on April 1st. And as most of you know, we are targeting the improvement of reading for students at grade 3 on statewide assessments. Our IDA grant activities are continuing to move forward. Our grant application is due next month, and we are supporting LEAs with the same for your individual grants. Our annual performance report, managers are still collecting data and providing technical assistance and support. and our general monitoring and supervision systems are up and running. We are still providing technical assistance and training opportunities. And I just wanted to update everyone and let them know that all of our work for the previous year and a half with regard to the IEP document is still moving forward. We have received bids for a statewide electronic data system. Our team's reviewing those bids currently, and we are, even through the crisis, we are still on track for being able to select a vendor for to support our new IEP document. However, over the last 3 weeks, our team has devoted most of our attention to supporting students, educators, and families during COVID-19 school classroom closures. And Michelle, I apologize, I'm having difficulty advancing the slides. Are you able to? Thank you. I'd just like to take this opportunity to thank the special education team for their around-the-clock efforts to address complex issues resulting from this pandemic. We're all getting used to a new way of working and a new way to operate as a unit, but our efficiency and expertise has not skipped a beat, so I really want to thank my team. The way we work and operate has changed with virtual meetings and collaborative efforts, but our goals to support you during this challenging time remain. Next slide, please. I'd like to just take a few moments to thank our partners. CERC's leadership and coordination to support the work of the Bureau has just been tremendous. As you are aware, all of the in-person activities have been canceled, but they are transforming any activities possible to be changed to the virtual format. That includes our 8-day leadership series, our PPTLI, which is Planning and Placement Team Leadership Institutes. Those are all still moving forward with support through a virtual format. Our work with Least Restrictive Environment is continuing, and our partnership with Francis Stetson to be able to train trainers throughout the state to assist teams in developing plans in the least restrictive environment for our students. We're also working with CERC to support your needs during this crisis. We're going to be sending out a needs assessment for school districts and redirect activities and resources and materials that you need at this time. Please look for that in the near future. A couple of highlights with our partnerships around the RESC Alliance. I'd like to thank them for their leadership as well. They've been critical partners in helping us develop resources with regard to distance learning, as well as meeting the needs of students with intensive special needs during this time. They are working on a parent portal or a parent page with the same to be able to support parents within the home environment around safety and activities to support students. They're transforming their related service communities of practice so that professionals can continue to collaborate and share best practice strategies. And finally, with regard to our partners at CPAC, we've been collaborating with them regularly, have ongoing communication, and are working on parallel documents for parents to ensure that they have the same information that our educators and special education administrative leaders have during this time. There will be a future communication from parents about information that we've received up to this point that will be shared, as well as a frequently asked questions document from parents. And we've heard from families and students about the fear, the unknown, the anxiety of the current situation, not knowing where they're going, if they're able to get through the next week, the next day, or even the next hour. So we are sensitive to families' needs and parent needs at this time, as the pandemic has affected us all. Although we are getting information out as quickly as possible, we're balancing that need with the need to gather input, insight, and understand perspectives, as the Deputy Commissioner opens with and informed you with in the open. Now more than ever in our state, we must work together collaboratively to approach the challenges that we face in a positive and proactive manner. Those of you who had heard me speak in the past, perhaps at back to school or other collaborative professional learning sessions, you've heard me speak about the importance of student voice as well. I'm really excited to say that we're connected with our two youth advisory groups, one through CIRC from students grade 6 through 12, and one that's supported by CPAC in our transition age advisory group, so that we can hear directly from students. The commissioner has held a recent session as well with high school juniors and seniors to determine what the challenges are for students, hear directly from them, what their thoughts are about important issues that we're facing, including grades, graduation. The commissioner mentioned how inspiring the students were and how important their perspectives are, and help remind us the reason why we do what we do. I just wanted to say again, I'm really thoroughly enjoyed and appreciated the discussions and conversations that we've had, brainstorming and the planning, all for our students. I'd like to thank superintendents, special education leaders, educators, parents, board and parent attorneys, the SEPTO advocates, parents, and of course, students themselves. It's an honor to be part of this work, and it's also been humbling as we are still working to provide information and address many unanswered questions in this changing environment. Change slide, please. Today, we all know that information in the health conditions within our state are changing rapidly. As such, please understand that the information that we share at this point in time will need to be updated frequently as new information becomes available. Up to this point, our communications have highlighted important priorities, including the health and safety of our educators, students, and families, communication, removing barriers for districts, and planning and implementing continued educational opportunities for students, and the need to be creative and solutions-based when utilizing staff to connect with students in new and innovative ways. We know the IDEA does not address situations in which there are statewide school closures due to a national health crisis. This is the law that we spend every minute of every day defending and supporting for our students. This is the law that drives what we do on a daily basis. As my colleague Jessa mentioned earlier, OSIRS has provided guidance in the past couple of weeks to assist states in navigating the conflict between statewide classroom closures and the IDEA. We need to approach this situation in a reasonable manner and use common sense and proactive measures. I would just like to briefly review a few key pieces of guidance that were recently released. Please note that this is not a comprehensive list of OSIRS documents and at the ed.gov. And for resources and guidance and a comprehensive list of those guidance documents, please visit the website on your screen. The March 12, 2020 Q&A on providing services to children with disabilities during the Corona Disease 2019 outbreak. That document contained a series of questions related to Part B and Part C of the IDEA. Many of the questions are no longer applicable in our state. There were scenarios about schools that were open, but the student was sick, perhaps. There were questions about some schools being open within the districts and others being closed. There was a question about students at risk and staying home, but with the school wasn't closed. But there were two main points that I wanted to highlight from that document for you this morning. When school is closed and services were not provided to any student, generally that means that the supports and services are not provided to students with disabilities. If, however, an LEA provides virtual educational opportunities, they must ensure equal access to the same opportunities, including FAPE, and ensure to the greatest extent possible each student with a disability be provided special education and related services identified in their IEP or Section 504 plan. The March 16, 2020 OCR fact sheet, just to highlight a couple of points there, with regard to all of us staying home, still highlighting the provision to maintain educational services. They once again highlighted the fact that short-term closures, there is no school and services are not provided for all students. The same would be true for students with disabilities. With an extended period of time, they indicated that individual determinations of compensatory services with respect to applicable requirements, including the need to make up for any lost skills during that time. In-person meetings were not required, and evaluations that required face-to-face assessment or observations would need to be delayed. With regard to the March 21, 2020 supplemental fact sheet, OSERS indicated that a good faith effort to educate students virtually should take place, urging all states and LEAs to continue to provide educational opportunities during this difficult time. As Jessa highlighted in her slide, they were looking to correct misunderstandings that the federal law would provide barriers to remote educations. Schools should not do nothing as a means by which to address matters pertaining to students with disabilities. They shared an example within that document in which a teacher was giving a reading assignment, and within that class, there was a blind or visually impaired student. And they talked about the accommodations that could be provided to that student, for example, calling the student and reading the document and/or providing a recording of the document so that the student could access the same information as his or her classmates. With regard to FAPE, they mentioned that FAPE was consistent with the needs to protect the health and safety of students with disabilities and those individuals providing education, specialized instruction, and related services to these students. How FAPE is to be provided may need to be different at this time of unprecedented national emergency. Many disability-related services may effectively be provided remotely, but the global pandemic has resulted in inevitable delays in providing these services. IEP teams must make individual determinations whether and to what extent the compensatory services may be needed when school resumes, and to collaborate creatively at this time to meet students' needs, considering all methods, whether it be high-tech, low-tech, or no-tech options. Within the second section of this document, I just wanted to highlight and quote that the OSERS mentioned as a general principle during this unprecedented national emergency, public agencies are encouraged to work with parents to reach mutually agreeable extensions of time as appropriate. We'll come back to this concept a bit later, but I wanted to make sure that districts and parents take note of that language. I would now like to briefly review and highlight a few important concepts with regard to the Bureau of Special Education March 24th guidance memorandum. Our guidance documents and resources can also be found by clicking on the link that was on the previous slide. The first concept is on March 24th, BSC released the guidance document to school districts to address and emphasize with what we've been talking about, safety, number one, first and foremost, the need for frequent and consistent communication between school and home, continued educational opportunities for students with IEPs, and special education procedural requirements. This document will be updated frequently because, as mentioned earlier, as the pandemic unfolds and information and conditions change, we will adjust. And slide, please. And one more. The first concept is equity. The continued educational opportunities that are provided to general education students must also be offered to students with IEPs and 504 plans. We realize that your districts are at different levels of capacity for delivering continued educational opportunities, and that you're working to improve these on a daily basis. There are numerous factors that contribute to the variability from district to district, school to school, and even student to student, including but not limited to student access to technology and materials, educators' access to the school buildings, resources, and the working conditions for our educators, not to mention the health issue that we are all facing. Some districts and schools have prepared comprehensive continued educational opportunities even prior to the onset of this pandemic, while others are just beginning the process. We are currently working to address the concerns that opportunity gaps will widen during this time and that our disengaged students will become more disengaged. The number of students facing mental health challenges will increase and/or intensify. This is why we all work together around the clock to be creative, constructive, and collaborative in proactively supporting districts to address these issues. Next click. Thank you, Michelle. You're doing a great job. I appreciate it. Individualized. Within the context of continued educational opportunities, schools must consider each student's ability to access instruction and provide necessary accommodations or modifications documented in the IEP to the greatest extent possible. However, PPT meetings are not required to discuss distance learning plans, and distance learning plans are not required to be documented in the IEP. Next click. Specialized instruction and related services. The school district's responsibility to provide a free and appropriate public education, or FAPE, remains during this crisis, as we spoke about a little earlier. FAPE has changed since children and young adults are not physically within schools. During school closure, IEPs are not able to be implemented in the same manner as they were prior to COVID-19 closures. However, students must be provided with specialized instruction and related services to the greatest extent possible while children are in the home environment, and students and young adults. A shift from traditional school to remote learning is challenging under ideal circumstances, and we're all aware that these are not normal circumstances. This pandemic will affect schools' ability to deliver services and students' ability to receive the services. We must be sensitive to the current conditions within our communities and do everything that we can to maintain positive relationships throughout. Communication is always important, but now more than ever, the BSE is available to assist and support you through this process. The document highlights a few important strategies at this time, at the time that it was released. And just briefly going through, to reach out to parents to let them know where you are in the process of providing educational opportunities. We've heard from families and surrogate parents that there's been very positive and proactive interactions. And then we've also heard the contrary, where parents have received little or no communication with and fearful of the unknown. Speaking with parents about their preferred methods of communication and including parents and students' input when designing these continued educational opportunities. And again, we've received information all along the spectrum with regard to educational opportunities, perhaps too much work being provided in activities to students, receiving little or no activities at that time. So to develop a process to assess, refine, and adjust and improve over time is really important. I really want to thank the districts and the educators for their efforts that have been made thus far. We've heard from concerns from educators also about students and families that they're unable to reach after multiple attempts. These are concerns that keep us up at night, but I know that we will work collaboratively to address these issues. It's also advisable to document activities that are provided to students during COVID-19 closures and to work with families to the extent that they are able to document the students receiving these activities at home. Next click. PPT meetings. Just some important concepts to share with you. We know that the IDEA requirements remain. As the Bureau of Special Education, we don't have the authority to relieve any of the PPT timelines and requirements. All face-to-face meetings have been postponed until further notice. PPTs may be held virtually. If annual reviews have been held and there is a need to revise the IEP, you remind district leaders that amendments are possible. However, again, given the national crisis, there are practical limits to compliance. I'd like to provide you with a bit of context as this pandemic has unfolded. And my colleague Jessa mentioned this originally in her slide as well. When schools were initially closed, thinking about those short-term closures of a day or two of cleaning, perhaps a week, Much like the OSER's guidance stated, when schools are closed and educational opportunities are not provided, the same would apply for students with disabilities. At that time, it would have been appropriate to not hold PPT meetings during short-term school closures, much the same as a weekend or a vacation or an extended holiday, thinking about those days being made up. As we progressed from March 31st to even delays to April 20th and potentially beyond, a different approach is needed. However, much like distance learning activities, the school district and a parent's ability to hold telephonic or virtual PPT meetings may vary. Districts cannot ignore the responsibilities to conduct annual reviews, triennial reviews, or other procedural requirements. However, once again, there are practical limits of compliance. Districts and parents should make thoughtful and deliberate decisions concerning the following when scheduling PPT meetings. One, health and safety of all involved members. Two, confidentiality and privacy, considering that folks are tuning in to the PPTs in the home environment with their family members and children. Meaningful participation of all members. That varies within homes as well as within schools right now. Some parents are working from home while trying to care for and maintain structure within the home environment. Also consider the purpose of the PPT meeting. I won't go through the different reasons to convene a PPT, but I've heard from directors of very successful meetings that have been held telephonically or virtually. For example, students transitioning from the hospital setting or an out-of-district placement where the need to convene the PPT was appropriate. As you can imagine, we've received input, community concerns related to all ends of the spectrum with regard to PPT meetings. We've heard from districts and parents who have successfully held those meetings, which I mentioned. We've heard from parents that are concerned about districts' ability to be able to hold PPT meetings. And on the opposite end of spectrum, we've heard from parents that were concerned, for a lack of a better word, feeling forced to attend virtual PPT meetings on short notice and not being able to focus on the matter at hand given the household situation. Please click. With regard to annual reviews, as I mentioned, those are still requirements for all students. If teams are not able to meet for the above reasons, meetings should be held as soon as they are able. If an IEP lapses, that IEP should remain in place until a new IEP is developed. Next click. With regard to reevaluations, student reevaluation PPT meetings that are due during school classroom closures are still required for students as well. However, face-to-face evaluations are not possible at this time. PPTs should not meet with incomplete evaluation information. Evaluations that are partially completed should be completed as soon as possible once it is safe to do so. And next click. With regard to initial evaluations, the initial evaluation process is paused at this time, as they typically require face-to-face evaluations and classroom observations. IDEA requirements remain, and again, I'm going to bring back the point earlier that I read from the OSERS document that says, as a general principle, during this unprecedented national emergency, public agencies are encouraged to work with parents to reach mutually agreeable extensions of time as appropriate. When making decisions about PPTs, there should be thoughtful and deliberate discussions and mutually agreeable outcomes, not unilateral decisions. We will continue to work to provide further guidance around the above requirements. Our national partners meet on a regular basis. I'm fortunate to be able to meet with my colleagues as state directors on a biweekly basis to discuss some of these important topics and concepts across the country. That we are not in this alone. You are not in this alone. It's a national collaborative effort to be able to support students with disabilities. Together, we'll navigate through this situation, and remember, we will get through these challenges together. Next slide, please. Just a reminder that if you have questions, please submit them through the COVID-19 email that's provided. We appreciate the emails and the questions that we receive. I wanted to let you know that we're working on updates to the March 24 guidance, that those processes are already underway. And our next steps include collaborative meetings to collect information from various stakeholders with regard to PPT process and to collect remaining questions to help inform our updated guidance. On March 31st, we had a memo that was released with regard to continued educational opportunities for APSEPs. We have a document that is nearly ready for release with regard to due process activities. And we're also working on other important topics, including FAPE at 3 for students transitioning from birth to 3 to the public school pre-K programs, issues surrounding related service providers, transition students aged 18 to 21, documentation of the ed opportunities, and assessment of the impact of school closures. We're also working on other important topics related to statewide classroom closures. And I just wanted to mention, next slide, please. We have devoted 2 consultants to address parent questions within our bureau. That is Jim Moriarty and Jay Brown. So we've shared that with our parent series. As the deputy commissioner mentioned, you can find our professional support series for families and districts on our website. This is the first of such series for special education, and there will be several more topics in the upcoming weeks. Once again, I'd like to thank everyone for joining us today and to listening into this information. And I'd like to thank the educators, especially, this time of crisis really provides an opportunity for our educators to shine. And I've heard very many positive stories about connections that schools and students are making. And I know that will increase, and I know that will grow over time. CSDA is committed to continued support of students, parents, and families during this pandemic. At this point, I will turn it back over to Michelle for questions and answers portion of our session. And Michelle, thanks again for advancing the PowerPoint. Appreciate it.
Sure. I want to thank you all for your leadership and guidance at this time. We do have a few questions, not too many. And the first one is for you, Brian. You might have covered it later on in the presentation, but if you could please mention, the question is, you have said districts can convene PPT meetings in unique circumstances. Please define unique.
Thank you, Michelle, and thank you for the question. So yeah, I think we covered that during the section when we were talking about PPT meetings. What we want folks to understand is that those requirements to meet and to convene PPTs remain. There hasn't been an alleviation of any of those requirements that we've heard from OSERS or from Congress at this point in time. So again, those are decisions that districts will have to make based on those 4 factors of confidentiality, safety, of the membership participation. We want to remind districts and parents that there is the ability to excuse members of the PPT that aren't able to convene for whatever reason, and they can use our form for doing so. So I don't know if there's anything else Jessa wanted to add on that.
Okay. I actually have another question for Jessa. Jessa, can you please clarify Executive Order 7R? You mentioned contracts must be amended. Please clarify.
Sure. So what the executive order says is that to the extent that a board of education or in cases where a municipality holds a contract, and there's a determination that the contract needs to be amended to more accurately reflect costs or services being provided, that in that case, the parties shall promptly negotiate amendments. So in the context of whether they must negotiate amendments, that's first contingent upon the board or the municipality determining that it's necessary to negotiate such an amendment. And I also want to mention that this executive order is in conjunction with guidance as well on, in particular, approved by private special education contractors from Brian's area, which suggested that SD is supportive of contracts being honored as is because there are so many complicating factors to attempting to address changes in those contracts. But in the context of this executive order, if a board determines that they must address significant changes in the contract or that they need to negotiate an amendment to more accurately reflect the actual costs incurred during this period of time, then the parties are to promptly negotiate such an amendment with some certain guiding factors, including sustaining continuity of services, continuing tuition payments and sustaining active employees as well, both in pay and in health insurance, and also ensuring that there's a reasonable assessment of the costs to sustain those items.
Great. I have another one. It might also be related to that, and it could be for you as well, Jessa. If we continue to pay our contractors slash providers, can we continue to claim those expenses for excess cost?
Yes, yeah, that's part of the reason for our suggestion. Obviously, I would recommend that any specific school consult with their board attorney as well, but it's our belief that the payment flow should remain the same, and that will provide the best continuity of services for our students, as well as the ability to ensure that we're capable of coming up and running as soon as we're able to resume classes.
Perfect, thank you. I have one last, I think it's my last one, but let me, and it's related to confidentiality. We didn't really address this in this session, but the question is, will you provide direction related to confidentiality to self-contained classrooms and the fact that all parents can view other students and hear their names? A similar question for related service providers when group sessions are held. Once again, when will we receive clarity on these confidentiality issues?
I can tell you that SDE is working on a guidance document around questions about privacy and confidentiality that I think should provide some more guidance around that. Although I still would urge, you know, part of what the document will likely do is urge districts to consult with their local experts and to try to develop concepts where they can provide the services without distributing any sort of personalized information, or consider asynchronous classrooms or other best practices to best address concerns about privacy and confidentiality. We can't hear you, Michelle.
Okay, now I had to unmute myself. All right, so thanks. I may have missed something. Are you saying FAPE standard has changed since children are not in the school building, or do you mean the provision of FAPE has changed? Brian, did you understand that?
Yep.
Okay.
Yes, I do. Yeah, the provision of FAPE. And I think, you know, just to talk a little bit about this just for a minute, you know, the general education landscape has certainly changed, and what is being provided is so different. So that's the foundation. It kind of goes back to that equity discussion of what is provided to all students must also be provided to students with disabilities. Within that context, the provision of FAPE remains. and IEPs need to be implemented to the greatest extent possible, understanding that IEPs were written at the time for students to be in school and to receive those services documented within the IEP.
Thanks. We have another one related to PPTs. If we're participating in PPT meetings and we're having difficulty getting the regular education teacher to participate because of distance learning and no subs, if the parent is in agreement, can we waive the general ed teacher and review the teacher report?
Yes, the form that we have, our state form, can be used to dismiss a PPT member and a general education teacher, as long as that information is provided and the parent is in agreement, then that PPT can move forward.
Great. We have a couple more regarding PPT. If we hold a virtual PPT, does everyone need to participate via video or is voice okay? And do new plans need to be based around new learning scenarios?
Michelle, could you repeat the second part of that question?
Yeah. Do new plans need to be based around the new learning scenarios? I think they mean like the way that they're learning right now.
Yeah, those are great questions. A PPT can be held telephonically. It does not have to be through video means. So to answer the first part of the question, and I think, you know, that second part of the question, this is information that we're collecting currently and working on providing updating guidance to teams as more and more teams will be meeting virtually or telephonically. I know these questions will need to be answered. That's why I consider the purpose of the PPT also. Is there a need to revise the IEP plan currently? With regard to annual reviews, we know the purpose of an annual review and why a team meets regarding the annual review, to review student progress towards goals and objectives. So it's very challenging for teams to be able to develop goals and objectives based on comprehensive student information and data about current levels of performance, and then be able to determine services long term. But there are very important reasons to meet for PPTs, especially this time of year with promotion and graduation and exiting and students moving from one building to the next and planning for extended school year services. So those are all determinations that the PPT will have to make in collaboration with the parent. But more information to come.
Thank you. Another question related to that is, how should the schools navigate triennials and initial referrals when testing is unable to be conducted?
Yeah, another great question. I would say in those scenarios that those processes would need to be delayed.
Okay, do you have any suggestions for schools that are having trouble getting parents to respond to emails and telephone calls in terms of the PPTs?
Yeah, I think those are that's a scenario where we have to get very creative and be sensitive for what families are going through at the same time. I think there's a cross-department initiative to look to be able to support families during this time that are either unable to be reached, or as the question, whoever posed the question mentioned, not responsive to emails or phone calls. So those efforts I know are happening across not only our department, but other agencies, because we know that we're all operating differently during this time of within the pandemic.
Thanks, Brian.
I would add, just to reiterate Brian's point, that is an area that we've received questions from districts that are concerned about not being able to make contact with families. And we've heard a few creative things that are occurring, but we're having that discussion internally to think about attendance, the supports that may be necessary, and also to talk with other agencies like DCF and collaborate on the guidance that we should be providing.
Okay, I'm being conscious of the time because we only have a few minutes left, but there are a lot of questions. So rest assured, those of you that have asked questions that we haven't had a chance to answer, we will produce a document with the questions in it and the answers that go along with your questions, or someone will reach out to you directly. Okay, so let me see, maybe we can take like one or two more. There was a question about reaching staff at DCF and that they're having trouble reaching someone at DCF regarding open cases. Is there somewhere they could go in terms of getting some action on that?
That's a great question. We have a call with DCF this afternoon, so we will certainly bring that up in that call. We were informed that everything was open and moving forward and that folks could still use the normal process or means to reach out to staff. But if I'm hearing that, they may be having trouble contacting, we'll certainly share that with our colleagues at DCF.
Okay. We'll take, I guess, one more. Let's see. So someone asked, I think this is just sort of for you to reiterate what you had mentioned during the webinar, Brian, but annual reviews of PPTs should be held during this period, question mark.
So the requirement for those meetings remains. There is not an extension of those timelines. Given the unique circumstances of the pandemic, we understand that teams may not meet those dates and that we have a system to be able to collect that data for the school districts. We mentioned in our guidance also that those infractions and those compliance related issues regarding annual reviews do not impact LEA annual performance reports, but we understand that the districts should make efforts to hold those meetings as soon as possible, given the factors that they're working with, both within their schools and within the family's home environment.
Okay, that's all we have time for today. And as I mentioned, we will certainly follow up in terms of the unanswered questions and get you the information that you need. There's contact information on the slide in front of you for each of the presenters, as well as the email information was shared if you have specific questions. Thank you again for taking the time out to attend this webinar. And as we mentioned before, we're here to help. We're all available, so please reach out. And thank you very much, and stay well, everyone.
Thank you.